joy that I feel today. In being able to actually see you, I've been shaking hands, you know. We've done this event through Zoom for the last couple of years, and that was entirely the right thing to do. I think all of the things that you've all heard about, the way that we've struggled to keep school coming to our children and your grandchildren, were entirely the right thing to do. But it is such a wonderful thing, again, to be able to be in the same room. So I just wanted to acknowledge how wonderful it is to actually see you physically. I think that's a really good thing. You know, I woke up this morning thinking about Grandparents' Day. First of all, my excitement at seeing you in person. You can imagine, as a school administrator, I'm generally someone who likes groups and being with nice groups of people like this. But the other thing I was thinking about is that my mother yesterday, who was herself a grandparent of an alumni student of our high school, my mother said to me, oh, that's the day where you invite grandparents to come and visit the school. I thought about it as I was in bed last night and this morning when I woke up, and I realized that's not exactly what today is. Today is the day that we acknowledge just how much every single one of you is a part of our school, is a part of our community, is an essential piece of the life that each one of these children in our building is living, is experiencing. You are very likely the grandparents of children who you live relatively locally, right? You can be here. Some of you may have come for this, which is an amazing thing. But every single one of our kids is benefiting from this larger circle that expands beyond the classroom, beyond the school, beyond the parents, into the grandparent world. So actually, today is not so much a day that we kind of gift to you. Today is a thank you from us to really say how much we appreciate. And there are some very tangible ways in which you support the school. I will say that grandparents were an essential part of our financial survival through the hardest days of COVID. We had many grandparents who really stepped up. Grandparents are an essential part of our volunteer force. We have grandparents who do things like run after-school study halls, who show up and run clocks and hold flags at volleyball games and all those kinds of things that you do. And those are deeply appreciated, and anyone who wants more involvement in those, we're happy to talk about. But most of all, what you are doing every day and every week and every month in your relationship with the children that are in our classrooms, you're bringing your experiences, you're bringing your interest in what they're doing. And I was on the Italy trip, not last week, but 2 weeks before that, I was in Italy for 10 days with our senior class. And I talked with them on one night at dinner about some of the things that had been the things they're really carrying away from their high schooling all the way through. Some of these students have been with us for 3 years of early childhood. So they're in their 15th year of school here. And one of the things that came up over and over in that conversation was that something that they truly valued in their school experience was being in a community, being in a place where other people were interested in them. You are not only here today supporting your own grandchild, but you are bringing the message to every children in the classroom that you see, that the wider community is interested in them, loves them, and supports them. Not just the one child that you are maybe, or two children, or three, or in one case, four I talked to this morning, genetically related to, but the fact that you are part of our school, and a part that we deeply appreciate and don't get to see enough. I'm so glad to be able to welcome you into our building today. Practically, you have in front of you a guide to the day. On the front is the schedule, and on the back is the map. To help a little bit, main entrance is where you came into the building, and we are currently in the gym, just to kind of help, because this map can cause all kinds of confusion. You're going to go off into classrooms, you're going to experience what's happening. You're all parents and grandparents and children, you know that it can be very exciting to have somebody in the classroom. There will be a few children who kind of lose it and get really excited, and you'll be like, oh, it's just their excitement about having a kid, don't worry about it. There might be a few that run the other way as well. That's just as fine, right? Just roll with it for us, we appreciate it. The teachers are a bit nervous. Until yesterday, they didn't really know how many people were coming to each classroom. So some of them were thinking 2 or 3, and it turns out it's 17. So a little bit of care for that, too, would be wonderful. And then the last practical thing I'll say is that we as a school have a pretty strong presence on Facebook and Instagram in particular. And I really encourage you, if you don't already follow the school, Derek, who's standing back there with the camera, has really, really worked on our social media appearance this year. And you will often see your grandchildren. And you will often see the things that are happening in their lives. And it's a nice way for you to be able to kind of have information and ask questions. And so I encourage you to do that if it's something you're interested in, if you follow social media. Thank you so much for coming. I am so pleased to see you all here.
Second grade, we're going to perform a poem about winter leaving us and spring joining us, hopefully very soon.
Everything's
back to normal. We're not fully back to normal, of course. Nothing really is after the last 2 years. But this has been the year that we've been able to open things up again, that we've been able to have this event in person for the first time in a few years. We've also been able to have other events at our school that we have not been able to do. And what we found is we are getting a large number of people coming to our community events. Parents, grandparents, some of you have been to some of them. Our concerts, we have been filled to capacity, which is fantastic because we all have been missing that personal connection, and we're able to do that again. And so for those of us who are involved in a lot of those community events, it's been really exciting to see that response and to have parents walking through the hallways again and being able to, you know, volunteering on field trips and all those things that we really couldn't do for a while. So we're really excited that you're all here. A couple things to just keep in mind, again, as I said, this is a chance for you to come in and see the classrooms and the experience and see the building. And some of you have been here many times before. Some of you, this is your first time, and it might be a little bit of, go check out what this welcome thing is all about. So if you have questions, please, I encourage you to ask. Any of us who are around, you've been here at the school for a long time, your grandchildren's teachers, parents, we are happy to share anything about the school. So a few things to think about just for you, because what's great is a lot of the students, they see you coming in and they know, like, oh, they want to know what I'm doing here. And so this is a chance for you, and you are here to build that connection with them. Moving forward after today, one way to do that is to ask them what they're learning about in school, reading books with them on those topics. It could be anywhere from Greek mythology to Norse myths to the Renaissance to Shakespeare, depending where they are in the curriculum. Asking to see the work that they bring home. So some of you may have seen some main lesson books. If you don't know what main lesson books are, each class has a main lesson in the morning that's 2 hours of class time. And they go through the curriculum, and we don't have textbooks here. They create their own textbooks with these beautiful drawings and color and writing and poetry. And so that's a big source of pride for our students. And so asking to see their main lesson book and sit with them and let them go page by page and explain what it is and the stories that they're illustrating on the books, on the pages. You'll learn a lot. I know I did whenever my kids would talk me through that a little bit and their artwork. We used to have, and I think before COVID, when my kids would bring home in June, all their artwork from the year, and we would sit down that first week of summer, and they would just put out their artwork all over the living room floor, and it's amazing what they do. So asking to see their artwork. Conversations with them, and asking about their non-academic things that they're learning and outside of school. You know, we have, for some of the older grades, the sports, and we've got different clubs, and ask them to show you how to knit, because I learned how to knit because my kids were coming to school, and I can knit a washcloth really well. I think they're much better than I am. But those little interests, and I'm not telling you anything that you don't already know. You're here, right? You are invested, and we really appreciate that.
Never mind it. Steiner parent, which I'll get into in a minute, and also now a grandparent. My wife Leila and I have been Waldorf Steiner parents for 35 years, I realized yesterday as I was preparing these remarks. When our oldest daughter Caroline started preschool here in 1988. So we have been affiliated with the Steiner community for a good many years. We've been Steiner grandparents now for 6 years. We have three grandchildren here at the school, one in early childhood, one in first grade, and one in fourth grade. Our oldest daughter, Caroline, has been a teacher here at this school since 2009, and is this year's third grade teacher, and as far as I know, is the first grades teacher who is actually an alum of the Ann Arbor Waldorf School. So kind of a first for the school, and we're very proud of that, obviously. In addition, all three of our adult daughters went to this school from preschool through 12th grade. All live locally, I'm pleased to say, and we have our five grandchildren all local as well. So in addition to our oldest daughter, Caroline, our middle daughter, Naomi, is a grief counselor with Arbor Hospice. And our youngest daughter, Emmeline, is the food services coordinator for Hope Clinic in Ypsilanti and is the board president of the nonprofit Washtenaw Refugee Welcome. We are very proud of our daughters and how they have used their Steiner education in service to the larger world, each in different ways, but very proud and very pleased with what they have done with the education they were given. Personally, as a longtime recycling and zero waste advocate, it's been particularly meaningful to me to be able to engage with the school with presentations that I've been able to make support for their environmental sustainability efforts. Waldorf Education, if you don't know, places a really large emphasis on understanding and embracing the awe and wonder of our natural world. So it is natural for them to support this work, but to also see them not just embrace the philosophy, but to also move forward with practical actions has been particularly inspiring. And I cite as an example the reusable dishware that we use today. It would be so easy for school, right, to just have disposable everything and be done with it. And they go the extra step to provide us with real tableware for today's event. So I think it's just one example of the kind of actions that the school is taking. While my solid waste experience and skill set and passion is unique to me, I know that the school is open, and I know some of you are involved with the school in your own way as well, bringing forward your skills and passions to serve the school as well, either in the classroom or in a whole school setting. Please consider, if you haven't already, how you might engage with the school to take your accumulated wisdom in service to your grandchildren, but also to the next generation of leaders. I think of the firepower that we have in this room of knowledge, of skills, of interests, of life perspective, that the power that we can bring to this school with who we are and what we've accumulated. Building an intergenerational school community promotes an exciting dynamic for any school, but I give the Steiner School here a lot of credit for really fostering those relationships with us. It's very easy, right? It's the default is to a school is for kids. But to take the extra step and say, well, let's look at the larger self, the larger person, and the social network that children enjoy. And let's engage those folks in the life of the school as well. So I'm really happy that that's the case. And I want to follow up a little bit on what Sean said this morning, that even if you're at a point in your life where you're not able right now to contribute time or energy into specific activities in the school, just being grandparents is also a tremendous gift that we bring to our grandchildren as well. So I want to lift that up. I don't want people to feel guilty that if for whatever reason you're just kind of not able to do something, you know, kind of in service to the larger school, just by being who we are and taking that role seriously and just being there to love these kids is tremendous. So, you know, I hope we all take that home with us as well. Another great way to be involved in the life of the school and with your grandchildren, of course, is through classroom activities specific to their grade, but also all school festivals, concerts, sporting events, plays. There's, I think, virtually every week there are multiple activities happening here at the school where you can participate. Some of them actually do sell out, and so space becomes a bit of an issue. But if you can, I have been forever amazed at the passion and the quality of the performances and activities that take place at this school. And maybe it's just because I was a doofus as a kid or something, but to see the quality and that it's not just one kid either. You know, music is for every kid, right? Instruments for every kid. Plays are for every kid. Chorus is for every kid. So everybody is participating in everything. So every child is getting an exposure that doesn't happen at very many schools, right? You've got to seek that thing out if you want that for your child or grandchild. But here, it's part of the curriculum. It's part of their identity. It's the whole class is doing everything together and experiencing that, even if it ends up not being a passion of theirs in the long run, that it's part of their educational experience here. And for a dose of optimism, energy, and inspiration, I think almost nothing beats it. And it's hard these days to find optimism, energy, and inspiration sometimes, you know, with what we're dealing with in our larger world. And so to find those, I would almost say sacred spaces to really appreciate, you know, that outpouring from children is absolutely wonderful. Financial giving is another way to pay it forward. I've been an annual fund supporter now for several years. I'm really pleased with myself this past year that I moved to an automatic monthly donation and built that into our family budget. In the past, I had just kind of done a kind of a once a year gift. And for some of us, that's not a problem, but for some of us, it's tough when you're on a budget to find a decent sum of money, you know, that you have extra, basically, that you can give away. So I have found it really helpful to be able to do that monthly giving online. And it allows me to be a little more generous than I could have been if I was just trying to make a once a year annual donation. Kind of whatever works for you, but I at least found that to be a really helpful way to be able to give more back to the school. For those of you who don't know, most independent nonprofit schools have annual funds, and those annual funds here support tuition assistance for about half of the families that are attending the school. It also provides professional development opportunities for teachers and professional staff. So as a parent of a staff member here, I appreciate that some of that funding goes to support my daughter and her continuing education as well. Tuition and fees cover about 90% of annual costs, but the school relies on the annual fund contributions to fund the remaining 10%, which remains substantial. And frankly, if they have a successful year, it allows them to be more generous with tuition assistance to those families that need it. So I encourage you to consider, if you're not already, donating through the annual fund. I think there's some information on the tables or elsewhere. You can see Lisa if you want to hear more about that. One of the options that's available for donating is the idea of taking your required minimum distributions, RMDs they're called, from traditional IRAs that allow charitable donations to be made and allow you to avoid taxes in the process. So if you have a traditional IRA and you're looking for an outlet for that as you have to start expending those funds, giving to nonprofits, including the school, is a great way to support their work as well, and you avoid the tax penalties of it. So I'm going to close as I get sentimental. I don't know if this is true of you. As I get older, I get more sentimental, I get more emotional. So I wanted to share a couple of quotes about grandparents my presentation that I found to be kind of inspiring and touching. The first one is from Fred Rogers, Mr. Rogers, who said, "Grandparents can be very special resources. Just being close to them reassures a child without words about change and about continuity, about what went before and what will come after." Mary Waldrop said, "Grandchildren are God's way of compensating us for growing old." I can relate to that. And then finally, Ruth Good said, "Grandparents are always told that they are living history to their grandchildren, that they give those grandchildren the reassurance of their roots. For me, and many grandparents I've talked to, it works the other way as well. They give us continuity." So, let's hear it for the power of our love. Blessings to all of you and your loved ones. Thank you.
Oh, built about 7 years ago by the school. We used to have all the lower grades in that one building. And not only for space reasons, but really to create a middle school experience that really met a modern adolescent for the end of the building. And so I had the pleasure of teaching here for many years. And so the idea of being separate from the younger kids, have their own space where they can sort of explore and be teenagers. It's really important to us, you know, as you know, raising your own kids or your grandkids, this is a very precious and tender time, adolescence especially, perhaps now in the modern age. And I've been very fortunate. My own three sons have gone through the school and been in this middle school building and have helped navigate their middle school years. I really can't think of a better place to have an adolescent than in a lower school right now. They get all these great opportunities to stretch their intellect, but also continue with their music and art and choir and gym class outside. And all those things that are so necessary to sort of balance life as teenagers tend to not want to be balanced, right? They want to be insular. They want to put their hooded sweatshirts on and their hoods up and hide for a couple of years, right? I had a teacher once tell me that we should just have a sign when the teachers do that. It just says under construction, right? That's really what they are. They're changing so much physically and emotionally and intellectually, and they just sometimes need to like just bear down, be with themselves in an overwhelming world. And so what we're trying to do here is help them navigate that world. And as you probably know, class teachers in our school stay with the children for many years. So my current class, which is in first grade, by the time we get up here to sixth grade, I'll be with them for 5 years already. And the advantage of that is manifold, but in the middle school experience, really you know the children so well. And then when they go through those difficult times in adolescence, or they need someone who can hold them accountable, know they're not doing their best work, right? Kind of get a little lazy sometimes in middle school, right? Need to be pushed through sometimes. And the teacher knows them really well to do that, right? Like all of our curriculum, the curriculum tries to meet them at where they are developmentally. What does that mean? We teach things at the right time, and to inspire them, to engage them, and to help them develop those burgeoning skills they have. You know, in first grade, we learn to draw on our main lesson books. And then in sixth grade, they're doing things like this, right? And so this is a really interesting project because this is a very important sixth grade project, which is done in the art room. So our middle schoolers get a double period of art once a week. So they spend about 2 hours with Ms. Taramina or Ms. Kaya in the art room, really focusing on skills and techniques. And the sixth grade drawing is really important. I'm going to go back to first grade for a second. So first grade, we spend every morning on a walk or in the nature. And part of that is to get them some energy out to play. Part of it is to observe. How many different bird sounds you hear today? There's the flowers coming out. You see the ice dripping off the trees, right? We want to make them aware of the world. It's very easy to walk through the world and not keep your eyes open. We want to keep those eyes open all through the school. And that sense of observation, that sense of wonder, serves them really well, like to middle school, when they can observe things very clearly. So this is an observational drawing of a paintbrush in a glass. And you can see what they're doing there is they're understanding in a very visual way this idea of refraction, which they learn in physics in middle school as well. And they're learning these techniques of only using a pencil to make different shapes. So you'll see in some of them they have these little guides for themselves as to what pencil makes a better shade or how hard you need to press on it. And so just simply using a graphite pencil they can make all these different shades and make the appearance of this glass, right? Even when you don't even see the side of it, it's there. And this paintbrush. But the real nice thing about this drawing for me is in sixth grade, and if you have a sixth grader or had a sixth grader recently or so, you know, they kind of see the world black and white. It's right or wrong. You're a hypocrite, right? You don't see me. And so we say, yes, you have a white page and you have black graphite, but you can make gray. Right? You can make those shades of gray. And that's developmentally a really powerful thing. Do we say that to them? No. Do they experience it? Yes. And that's sort of what we try to do, these little attempts to have these lessons they learn through arts or through music. We, as someone asked me before, the instruments, you know, our middle school students are all play in the orchestra. They all sing, they all do art, they all do handwork. They all do math from Mr. Sherman. They all do woodworking, right? And so we want them to have hands-on experiences, both in the classroom and in their subjects, where they can really fill the things in a deeper way. And so I have found teaching adolescents in this environment to be really rewarding. It can be very challenging, of course. But our curriculum, where we explore the world through geography, and we explore physics and chemistry and environmental science, and explorers. Right? Eighth grade now is doing, I think we're doing anatomy, we're doing physiology. So all these really, you know, meaty intellectual topics that they're ready for, because of all the things we've done in the first 5 grades, they're not ready for experiments. And so I am happy to answer any questions if you have any, or anything you wanted me to talk about otherwise. I don't want to flip you up either, you might have lunch with me. Yeah.
Are there wind instruments, or is it all string?
Wind and string, yeah. The winds are usually smaller, so they're in the classroom. But starting in fifth grade, the students, so all the students start playing violin in third grade. Actually start playing recorder in first grade. But violin in third grade, and then in fifth grade, they get a choice to stay with a string instrument or to go to a wind instrument. So you have some students who move to cello or viola or stay with violin or bass, and then you have some who switch over to the winds, the flutes, clarinets, trumpets, trombones. And then they, in the middle school, they practice separately generally. They come together for a concert. That'd be twice a year.
I know that some people say that the public schools might be better for math and science. Do you disagree and why?
I very much disagree.
So do I, but tell me.
So first of all, the way we teach math here is, so in first grade, traditional way to teach math is to bring addition and subtraction, and then maybe the next year bring multiplication. We bring it all at the same time. And we try to learn this facility with numbers. And we build on that in first grade, second grade, third grade. By fourth grade, they get the fractions. Pretty much tracks public schools. Middle school, we have a math specialist. It was excellent. They get a specialized math class 3 or 4 times a week. By the time they leave here, they are ready for any high school math, whether it's algebra or pre-algebra. And I think what I like about the math here is that it's really thorough, and we want to get the right answer, but we want to get the right process, and really talk on that, and care for your work and organization, and those skills that really are so important if you're going to carry forward to higher math, high school and college. And science, you know, we start our sciences, you know, really, you can say we start sciences in there. early childhood when they bake bread, they learn how to mix things together. That carries through a few grades. And then we formally start physics in sixth grade. So they'll get physics in sixth grade, seventh grade, and eighth grade. They get chemistry in seventh grade, and eighth grade. Environmental science in all those blocks. So they get a real foundation of science. But the way we teach science is what we call the phenomenological method. So in a normal science class, you might have a teacher come here and say, okay, today we're going to learn about conduction and, right? And so in physics, we won't do that. Or expansion and contraction, right? We will not say that to people. What we do, we'll have an experiment, we'll have experience. So I would, I should have that. I might have a copper tube that has a little ring on it and a ball that fits through it, right? And then you heat up the ball through the tube, right? Like that. So we give them these experience, the wonder of it, the beauty of it, and for themselves, think about what's going on, why is that happening? And then we talk about it. So it's this reversal of how science is probably often taught to us and generally taught, that we give them the phenomenon first, the wonder and the interest, and they should be careful observers, their eyes and ears, and then they can hear what happens. And so it's a really thorough way of teaching science. And I think for my own students, my oldest son is a senior now. Science isn't his thing. But he had chemistry in seventh grade, eighth grade, and he just kind of dreaded it. It's not my thing. And then just the last couple of years, building on his experiences, he realized all he had learned and what he could do with his knowledge. In the high school, he teach biochemistry in 12th grade.
This whole education, because there is a vision, kindergarten, early childhood, all the way through the senior year. Some students come for 1 year, some come for a few, some come for the whole thing. It's different. But however your grandchildren and your grandchild friends however they are experiencing this place, I'm going to try to give the panorama, okay? So although I like to think of myself as a detailed person, this is the panorama, and I will try to offer a couple of guiding words as a start. Since I am still teaching, I like to talk. I could go on too long. I'm going to resist that. I might turn to my watch or the clock from time to time. And I might ask you to do something.
But of course, you don't have to if you don't want to, right? There might be a moment of participation. And you know, you can do whatever you want because you are grand friends and grandparents. So feel free to ignore me, is what I'm trying to say. All right, a couple of very, very small facts, and then on to our key words. So these schools began this type of education, Waldorf, Steiner, it's the same thing. They began in 1919. Like Montessori schools, they were begun with the idea of serving the most marginalized people in a given country, in one case Germany, in the other case Italy. It's to me ironic that here in the United States, if you want a Waldorf education or a Montessori education, most of the time you have to pay for it. You have to pay a lot. That was not the original impulse. There are charter programs, but the original impulse was really to serve all children, and that was made possible by some amazing benefactors, but that's another story. Next thing that I will say generally is that in 1919 it was very unusual for girls and boys to be educated together. It was very unusual for schools not to be associated with the state or the church. It was very unusual, in fact, revolutionary for schools to be administered collectively. So we don't have a pyramid structure. I mean, you heard from probably Shano and Cruz this morning, did that happen? Yes. Some of you were here, right? So she is the all-school administrator. What that mostly means is more worries and less power, in some sense. So, and then you heard from Kim, who has charge of this campus, but really the structure is very collaborative. And in 1919, that was wild. The other thing that was totally wild, which is less wild now, is that educating all children, all subjects. So you may have seen your grand friends working with their hands, jumping, moving, dancing, singing, reading a really tough academic article they were doing in the eighth grade with Mrs. Brown. All kinds of intelligences, because Steiner thought, you know, we don't just think, we do other things. We learn with our hands, we have a mathematical side, we have a literary side, we have a kinesthetic side, we have an artistic side. Some people have high degree of emotional intelligence. So this is kind of mainstream. But in 1919, this idea that you should educate all the sides of a human being was really radical. That is getting much more mainstream. So that's another general principle. And then I'll say one other very general principle, which is relationships. We are keen establishing relationship with all of you, but obviously every single day with all of the children, among all of the children, with parents, among the parents, teachers to teachers, colleagues, among the colleagues, administration, staff, faculty, all this big giant weaving. And that it doesn't stop there. So relationships with people, this weaving together, is really important to us. Now, you know that it's not paradise here. I mean, look outside, it's snowing, right? and it's not always paradise in a school, but this is as close as it gets anywhere on this planet that I've experienced. We have little things come up, issues, questions, and we try to take those challenges and just continue to weave that beautiful fabric. There's a wonderful little folk tale about a young woman weaving a rug in what was then called Persia. It's not called Persia anymore. And she makes a mistake. And the teacher says to her, oh, turn the mistake into the most beautiful part. And that's kind of our mission here. So always more beautiful, always more relationships. What else about these relationships? We teach the subjects in a relationship. So science, for example, botany perhaps relates to also how life works for people in different neighborhoods based on how many trees are growing there. There's a social aspect to that. Teaching about the skeletal system, there is an aspect of bringing in someone's biography who overcame tremendous obstacles to develop a way for people who could not use their legs to ski. There, that came right into the discussion of the femur. I mean, it was fantastic what I saw this morning. So the relationships between what we call humanities, the arts, science, yes, we do a lot of science here. It's all science, starting with a mutt in the kindergarten, in the early childhood. It's all curiosity and exploration, which to me is real science. And the language program, our exchange programs through the high school. So that's another key fact, relationships. People, subject matter, and then I would say also, what we teach is important, but even more important is how and when. So you know there are a lot of debates about education today, here, there, and everywhere. And sometimes I just want to go to all of those people and say, have you looked at a Waldorf school? Because we really, we want to preserve the innocence of childhood, but we are educating towards the real world, towards a sense of profound truth and justice. And so what we do when is really critical. I could answer too many questions about that later. Based on a theory of child development that is about the whole child, body, soul, and spirit, what do we teach when? How can we get the most optimal moment? But also how? So you know the what. There's a lot of debate nationwide about the what. We have a lot more emphasis on when and how. So now is going to come a moment where you might not want to get out of your chairs. I don't blame you. But you might just want to watch me be very silly. That would be okay. However, it's an opportunity for you to imagine yourself as, say, an 8-year-old, maybe going on 9, and experiencing something in your morning's lesson that's a little bit about the how we teach. And I'll explain it later. It just ruins it if I just say too much right now. So here's what's going to happen. Some of you, brave, cheerful souls, to whom I will be forever grateful, are going to stand in front of your chair, and you're just going to try to do what I do, okay? It's not, I don't think it's dangerous. I'm just saying. Recovering from a very injured foot, which would have taken me one day 20 years ago. I'm all about avoiding danger. But this is not that. So, if you don't mind, you can just stand up, those of you who want to, and you just follow along. And don't worry, nothing bad can happen. So, no worries. Okay. Just, I'm going to say a little poem and I'm going to do some things. Okay? Try if you want. Don't film down.
I'm only using your voice.
Okay, good.
Does that help?
That would not be fair.
Nope, I'm only using your voice. I just want to get closer for this.
It's about a cat and a mouse, okay? A cat lived in a fine brick house, chased by a small, tasty mouse. The mouse ran by, the cat jumped high, was much too late. Mousey's out the gate. Okay, we're going to do that one more time. You know, you're not bad. I've been in groups where none of this has happened. So here we go. It's a cat and a mouse, right? A cat lived in a fine brick house, chased by a small, but tasty mouse. A mouse ran by, but a cat jumped high, was much too late. Mousey's out the gate. Great. Now, dear wonderful students, that wasn't bad. We're going to do it a little bit faster. One times four is four, two times four is eight, and then a few days later you mix them up. You may sit down. Bravissimo, you did it. So, so remember we have these key words, kind of like when. So not just what. What is an interesting question, and that seems to be a debate. Nationwide, but it's actually much more boring than the words when and how. So when do we introduce various things based on a very profound understanding of child development? We teach everything. Question is, when? And how? The younger the child, the more movement, the more kinesthetic, the more singing, you know, et cetera. You probably heard some this morning. The more drama, the older the child, the more immediately to the thinking. But even in this morning's anatomy lesson, the teacher had the students getting their feet really wet, stamping on a piece of paper, drawing around it, and watching which parts faded first, okay? There's always a bit of a doing. There's a bit of an emotional piece. There's a bit of a doing. So how we teach, with great access to multiple intelligences, with thinking about our wonderfully diverse nation, with a thinking about the whole world, with a thinking about joy. I mean, I'll just say it. Isn't it more fun to do this, even if you're embarrassed, than to sit at a desk as a small child and just be told, today is the fours times tables, or even doing it on your smart pad for times tables. This is way more fun. This education is about effectiveness and joy. So you can keep those words in mind, like when and how. Then I want to add two more words. I should have requested a chalkboard because it's way more fun to kind of write things on a chalkboard. Have you noticed that we do not shy away from handwriting? Have you actually noticed that? There's handwriting all over the place, in children's books, on the walls, in the chalkboards. Okay, two more words. Now I will be very didactic, as if I were speaking to an 11th grade class, I apologize. Does anybody know, somebody in here does, somebody does. Does anybody know the etymology of the word focus? Anybody? Some of you Latinists out there? Yeah, good. Okay, I'll answer my own question. So, it is from the Latin, of course, but it meant in ancient times the domestic fireplace, the hearth, that was the focus. Now, you all know when you've been at a campfire or something like that, or even just looking at a candle, it does tend to draw you in, and you really focus. Okay, so that image of being drawn in together and the hearth, the fire, it's in our language. You know, our language is made up of Greek, Latin, and a lot of Germanic words as well, and then many borrowed words. So, focus. What do I mean by this in this context? Okay, I got 2 minutes. What I mean is, basically, we are trying to instill inner focus. We're not doing it by rules from the outside. I mean, we have some rules too. But mostly we're trying to instill the human capacity to focus on something that is hard, that is a task perhaps, that is a challenge, and not give up. And, you know, to that end, I'll just add a little note. Most high schools now in the last 3 years have totally given up on cell phones. Everybody has their cell phone out all the time, during class, during lunch. I've talked to high school freshmen, friends of friends who are in tears because nobody wants to talk to them at lunch because everybody's just on their phone. But it's through class, too. Even 5 years ago, I visited a friend of mine who teaches public high school at an alternative school in Tennessee, and everybody had their phones out, and I was astonished. And I said, oh my gosh, Kate, how do you deal with that? She said, there's no buy-in to putting the phones away, so I just assume people are only listening maybe half the time. So we're all about focus and instilling it from the inside out. And one way we do that is with a lot of storytelling from the youngest ages, human stories. It's wonderful to also use picture books, which we do, absolutely. But the human story, the content like we're doing right now, you're looking at me, I'm looking at you, I feel you, I feel all of you. That contact helps young children develop the capacity to make inner pictures. They don't need the screen. The movie is running in their head, and they are making that movie. That's really important to us for lots of reasons. That's the basis of entrepreneurial research and entrepreneurial life. It's the basis of imagination, which we consider to be a powerful and creative force. It's not some frill. It's the basis of attention. So that's another word for you, that wonderful derived from the Latin focus. And then the other word I'd like to leave us with is actually two words, human beings. Around here, we still really love human beings. And we love little ones. Medium-sized ones, teenagers normally, usually, our colleagues on a good day. Just kidding. We love human beings, still. And we still think that although there are many, many uses, really wonderful uses for all kinds of technology as the students get older, we still think the most effective teaching is between a human being and a young person. That's not to say you can't learn in other ways, and that's not to say you won't learn in other ways, and that's not to say there aren't amazing ways for all of us to keep learning, but
In these years, say age 3 to 18, the most effective way to learn not only content, but skills for your whole life, empathy, imagination, compassion, all of those things, is between human beings. So we really believe in that. And that does sometimes mean, like the rug weaving story, you know, there will be occasionally mistakes, but that's the beginning of something creative or something transformative. So if somebody asks you about this event, you can say whatever you want. But if you get really stuck, somebody says, what is this Waldorf education thing? You could talk about multiple intelligences. You could talk about when child development and how and joy. You could talk about real focus. And trust me, it's getting harder and harder to develop that. That doesn't mean I'm pessimistic about the future. It just means it's a fact. It's harder and harder to develop that kind of focus these days. And you could talk about human relationships, teachers being human beings, not robots. And that's part of what we do here. Of course, there are many other wonderful things you've heard about, or you've seen or experienced. You guys, we're not bad at this. You could try to teach some other people. It's basically shoulders, and then you cross. This is crossing the midline. This is super important for brain development. Then you, this is called patching, when you slap your thighs, and then you cross. So shoulders, cross. That's all it is. Of course, if we were doing the threes, or the sevens or the nines, there's going to be a different movement, right? But that's enough for today. So this is an amazing way to educate young people. It's joyful, it's effective, and we are so delighted after kind of the hiatus of COVID years that you are all here. Kim, can I ask for a few questions? Is that allowed? What kind of schedule are we on?
Yes, well, we're going to wrap up at 2:30, so we have a few minutes. But I am going to just, I'm going to jump in before questions. If any of you have grandchildren that are going to be going home with you early, we do need you to go into the office and sign them out. We need to know which students are leaving early and not going out at regular dismissal. But otherwise, you can just answer
That's
questions.
Awesome.
And yes, thank you.
In the midst of experience teaching, you have to move.
What are the rules? Okay, obviously things change and different groups require different rules. But I will say this, I'll just answer it really personally right now. So this may not be everybody's answer. There are lots of other teachers around here. You can ask them too. Yes, there are school protocols and policies and a handbook and all of that. But in my mind, the two most important rules for classroom life are very simple. No cruelty and no laziness. Now, if you're lying off to the side on a pillow, but you're, a poem is coming to you, I don't consider that necessarily lazy. But the thing is, students, we get to know our students really well. Because, of course, in the grades, the teacher stays with the class a number of years. And the early childhood teachers often know their students very well. And in high school, we spend the first hour of every high school meeting talking about students. So we share them in a certain sense because we teach out of our expertise in the high school. But yes, we're spending 1 hour. So we know them. But as a personal answer, I'll just leave it at that. No laziness and no cruelty. Are there other questions? Various. Oh, yes, Ian, thank you.
I know Kim's opening remark referred to a student having the opportunity to be in your first grade class.
Oh, really? That she said that song?
So our granddaughter Erwin was so honored. And 2 weekends ago, she talked a little bit about etymology.
Yes. Good.
Elucidate.
She probably got that. She's a sophomore. She probably got that in a required sophomore class called etymology. I'm guessing. Interesting, though. And I love the opportunity to think about Eowyn and say her name. Your name. Beautiful. That whole word, also sophomore, okay, you guys know it's from Greek, right? What does it mean? Sally knows. So, you know, sophomore is like from the word philosophy, wisdom. Soft, that part. Other part is from the word for moron. So literally what sophomore means from ancient times is wise. Ooh. And that is a picture of many sophomores. Not even, but many. And that is why just at that perfect moment, they have a course simply called etymology, which also, you know, everything we're doing is hearkening backwards and looking forward. They often say that class is the most meaningful because they say we don't take words for granted. You know, they have a depth of meaning. And I'm happy to say that a couple of students I was recently in contact with who are now freshmen at Kalamazoo College, I asked them, what languages are you studying? They both had Spanish here all the way through and felt they got really quite far along. And they said, well, in college, you know, there are many options. So one is studying Arabic, and the other one is already reading and writing Japanese. And I just said, bravo. You know, that is another kind of fulcrum here. When you go to college, if you're so inclined, don't just stick with Spanish, take Swahili, take Arabic, take Indonesian, pretty easy for English speakers to learn. Take Vietnamese, you know, Chinese has 4 tones, Vietnamese has 6 and 18 pronouns. And go for it, because you're going to be in a room with a professor and 2 other kids probably. You're just going to have the best of the best. But long way of saying, language, its roots, its meaning, really important to us. As well as, I hope some of you are at the high school and heard some conversation about the sciences at the high school, how things are approached. I wish I could talk about that too. Great, thank you, Ian. But you didn't get that from me. And let's have one more, if there is one more. Otherwise, we are on schedule. It's kind of a miracle. Yes.
Yeah, do you teach any forms of meditation when you were talking about going inside and having a sense of self as opposed to being in the outside world all the time?
That's a great question. Remember our 2 keywords, when and how. So sort of like actively teaching that a little bit in the life skills wellness classes in the high school. Yes. All the way along, we are teaching it, but we're not saying that. And there is a sense of deep reverence cultivated, you know, even how we treat materials, treat the things we find out in the woods with the little children. There's always a sense. There are also little poems and verses about basically reverence and kind of looking inside, looking outside. So I would say explicitly, in a small way, different approaches in the high school in a couple of courses. Implicitly, it's kind of like all the way along. And that also applies, you know, to our faith traditions as well. And also to traditions of humanism that don't rely on faith. So we're trying to bring somehow the whole human experience here. So that when the students leave us, they're free. have a wealth of experience to draw upon and a wealth of knowledge too. Yeah, great question. Well, dear wonderful people, I think we might have to stop now. And Kim gave a little announcement about signing out your grandchildren. I'm hanging around here for